25. The Zhenyuan immortal gives chase to catch the scripture monk. Pilgrim's son greatly disturbs five villages abbey. We were telling you about the three brothers, who went to the main hall and said to their master, "The rice is almost done. Why did you call us?" "Disciples," said Tripitaka. "I didn't want to ask you about the rice. They have something called the ginseng fruit in this abbey, which looks like a newborn infant. Which one of you stole it and ate it?"
"Honestly,"
said Eight Rules, "I don't know anything about it, and I haven't seen it."
"It's the one who is laughing. It's the one who is laughing," said Clear Breeze.
"I was born with a laughing face," snapped Pilgrim. "Don't think because you have lost some kind of a fruit that you can keep me from laughing."
"Disciple, don't get angry," said Tripitaka. "Those of us who have left the family should not lie, nor should we enjoy stolen food. If you have in truth eaten it, you owe them an apology. Why deny it so vehemently?"
When Pilgrim perceived how reasonable this advice of his master was, he said truthfully,
"Master, it's not my fault. It was Eight Rules who overheard those two Taoist lads eating some sort of ginseng fruit. He wanted to try one to see how it tasted and told me to knock down three of the fruits. Each of us brothers had one. It's true that we have eaten them. What's to be done about that?"
"He stole four of the fruits," said Bright Moon. "And still this monk could claim that he's not a thief."
"Amitabha Buddha," said Eight Rules, "if you stole four of them, why did you only bring out three for us to divide among ourselves? Didn't you skim something off the top already?"
So saying, Idiot began to make a fuss again. When the immortal lads found out the truth, they became even more abusive in their language. The great sage became so enraged that he ground his steel-like teeth audibly and opened wide his fiery eyes. He gripped his golden hooped rod again and again, struggling to restrain himself and saying to himself, "These malicious youths. They certainly know how to give people a lashing with their tongues. All right, so I have to take such abuse from them. Let me offer them in return a plan for eliminating posterity, and none of them will have any more fruit to eat. Dear Pilgrim." He pulled off a strand of hair behind his head and blew on it with his magic breath, crying,
"Change."
It changed at once into a specious pilgrim, standing by the Tang monk, Wuzhuang, and Wuneng to receive the scolding from the Taoist lads. His true spirit rose into the clouds, and with one leap, he arrived at the ginseng garden. Whipping out his golden hooped rod, he gave the tree a terrific blow, after which he used that mountain-moving divine strength of his to give it a mighty shove. Alas! Leaves fell, limbs cracked, and roots became exposed. The Taoists lost their grasp of reverted cinnabar. After the great sage had pushed down the tree, he tried to look for the fruits on the branches, but he could not find even half a fruit. The treasure, you see, would fall when it met with gold, and both ends of his rod were wrapped in gold. Moreover, iron is also one of the five metallic elements. The blow of the rod, therefore, shook loose all the fruits from the tree, and when they fell, they became assimilated to the earth once they touched the ground, so that there was not a single fruit left on the tree.
"Fine. Fine," he said. "Now all of us can scram."
He put away his iron rod and went back to the front. With a shake of his body he retrieved his hair, but the rest of the people, like those of fleshly eyes and mortal stock, could not perceive what had taken place. We now tell you about the two immortal lads, who ranted at the pilgrims for a long time. Clear Breeze said,
"Bright Moon, these monks do take our reproach quite well. We have been upbraiding them as if they were chickens all this time, but not once have they even attempted to answer us. Could it be that they really did not steal the fruits? With the tree so tall and the leaves so dense, we could have made a mistake in our tallying, and we might have chided them unjustly. We should go and investigate further."
"You are right," said Bright Moon, and the two of them accordingly went back to the garden. But what they saw was only a tree on the ground with broken boughs and fallen leaves, without so much as a single fruit on it.
Clear Breeze was so aghast that his legs gave way and he fell to the ground. Bright Moon shook so violently that he could hardly stand up. Both of them were scared out of their wits. We have, as testimony, this poem. Tripitaka went westward to the Long Life Mount. Wukong cut down the grass of reverted cinnabar. Boughs broken and leaves fallen, the divine root exposed. Clear Breeze and Bright Moon were horrified. The two of them lay on the ground, hardly able to speak coherently. They could only blurt out, "What shall we do? What shall we do? The magic root of our five villages' abbey is severed. The seed of this divine house of ours is cut off. When our master returns, what shall we tell him?" Then Bright Moon said, "Elder brother, stop hollering. Let's pull ourselves together and not alarm those monks. There's no one else here. It has to be that fellow with a hairy face and a thunder god beak, who used magic unseen to ruin our treasure. If we try to talk to him, he will probably deny it, and further argument may well lead to actual combat. In the event of a fight, how do you suppose the two of us could stand up to the four of them? It would be better if we deceived them now by saying that the fruits were not missing, and that since we made a mistake in our counting, we were offering them our own apology. Their rice is almost cooked. When they eat, we shall even present them with a few side dishes. When each of them is holding a bowl, you stand on the left of the door and I'll stand on the right, and we'll slam the door shut together. We'll lock it and all the other doors of this abbey too, so that they will not be able to escape. We can then wait for Master to return and let him do with them what he wills. Since the Tang monk is an old acquaintance of Master, he might decide to forgive them, and that would be his act of kindness. Should he decide not to, however, we have at least managed to catch the thieves, for which we ourselves might be forgiven." When he heard these words, Clear Breeze said, "You are right. You are right." The two of them forced themselves to look cheerful as they walked back to the main hall from the rear garden. Bowing to the Tang monk, they said, "Master, our coarse and vulgar language just now must have offended you. Please pardon us." "What are you saying?" asked Tripitaka. "The fruits were not missing," said Clear Breeze. "But we couldn't see them clearly because of the dense foliage. We went back again to have a second look and we found the original number." Hearing this, Eight Rules chimed in at once. "You lads, you are young and impulsive, quick to condemn before you even know the truth of the matter. You throw out your castigations at random, and you have accused us unjustly. It's blasphemy." Pilgrim, however, understood what was going on. Though he did not say anything, he thought to himself, "It's a lie. It's a lie. The fruits were done with. Why do they say such things? Could it be that they have the magic of revivification?" Meanwhile, Tripitaka said to his disciples, "In that case, bring us some rice. We'll eat and leave." Eight Rules went at once to fetch the rice, while Sha Monk set the table and chairs. The two lads brought out 7 or 8 side dishes, including pickles, pickled eggplants, radishes in wine sauce, string beans in vinegar, salted lotus roots, and blanched mustard plants for master and disciples to eat with their rice. They also brought out a pot of fine tea and 2 mugs, and stood on either side of the table to wait on them. As soon as the four of them had taken up their bowls, however, the lads, one on each side, took hold of the door and slammed it tightly shut. They then bolted it with a double shackle brass lock. "You lads made a mistake," said Eight Rules with a laugh. "Or else your custom here is rather strange. Why do you shut the door before you eat?" "Indeed," said Bright Moon. "For good or ill, we will not open the door until after we have eaten." Then Clear Breeze lashed out at them, saying, "You bulimic and gluttonous bald thieves! You stole and ate our divine fruits, and you were thus already guilty of eating the produce of someone's garden without permission. Now you have even knocked over our divine tree and destroyed this immortal root of our of five villages abbey. And you still dare to speak to us defiantly. If you think you can reach the western heaven to behold the face of Buddha, you will have to ride the wheel of transmigration and do it in the next incarnation." When Tripitaka heard these words, he threw down his rice bowl and sat there weighed down, as if by a huge boulder, on his heart. The lads then went to lock both the front gate and the second gate, before returning to the main hall to revile them once more with the most abusive language. Calling them thieves again and again, the two lads assailed them until it was late, when they then left to eat. After the meal, the lads went back to their own room. The Tang monk began to complain at Pilgrim, saying, "You mischievous ape. Every time it's you who cause trouble. If you stole and ate their fruits, you should have been more forbearing to their reproach. Why did you have to knock down even their tree? If you were brought into court, even if your old man were the judge, you would not be able to defend yourself when you behave like that." "Don't scold me, master," said Pilgrim. "If those lads have gone to sleep, let them sleep. We'll leave tonight." "Elder brother," said Sha Monk, "all the doors have been locked securely. How can we leave?" Pilgrim said with a laugh. "Never mind. Never mind. Old monkey will find a way." "You have a way, all right," said Eight Rules.